Thank you, Jamel. Thank you, worship team. We come this morning to look at one of Jesus' sermons. I've titled this sermon, Best/Worst Sermon Ever, because of the reaction that Jesus' hometown crowd had to his sermon. Preaching is sort of an interesting activity because it's a challenge sometimes to evaluate how are you doing as a preacher. Sometimes you evaluate it by amens. And by the way, I am not a preacher that asks for amens. To me, well, I don't know. I don't want to, if you've ever heard a comedian who's asked people to laugh, that's a bad sign. If you have a preacher who's asking people to amen, on the one hand, I understand it. He wants to make sure people are listening. But if you want to amen, I mean, just go ahead. That'd be great. Thank you. I appreciate that. Let's see, you're listening, I know. How do you evaluate how your sermon is landing? And preachers in general are notoriously bad at evaluating this. So, for example, last week, three people joined the church. And an unusual number of people told me afterward that my sermon was good. And it's sort of a six of one, half dozen of the other. Was the sermon good because people joined? Or did people join because the sermon was good? I like to think that people told me my sermon was good because people joined the church. And so that's my recommendation to pastors. Have people join the church, and then people will tell you that your sermons are good. So Jesus preaches this sermon in Nazareth, which starts out being universally praised, and everyone is really excited about it. And the sermon ends with them wanting to throw him off a cliff. That's a pretty dramatic switch. However you evaluate that, the sermon made an impact on people. And it's sort of hard sometimes for preachers to evaluate it. There's the story of a traveling evangelist who said, when everywhere Paul went and preached, there was a riot. Everywhere I go to preach, they serve chicken for lunch. Or maybe we're missing something here. Look with me at Luke chapter 4, and we're going to look at verses 14 through 22, the first part of this story, the part that is the good part, the best sermon that these people have ever heard. And then we'll look at the worst sermon that they've ever heard in a little bit. Starting in verse 14 of chapter 4, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. News about him spread through all the surrounding district, and he began teaching in their synagogues and was praised by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. And the book of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. And he opened the book and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are downtrodden, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord." And he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed upon him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And all were speaking well of him and wondering at the gracious words which were falling from his lips. And they were saying, "Is this not Joseph's son?" We find out in this passage that Nazareth was not Jesus' first stop. This is his regional tour. It says in verse 14, Jesus returned. Where he returned from was his temptation in the wilderness. He had been baptized by John the Baptist. God had spoken from heaven and said, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased." And then the very next thing that happens is the Spirit leads him out into the wilderness. And there the devil asks him some pointed questions and offers him some opportunities to be a certain kind of Messiah. Jesus refuses those and says instead he is going to do the will of God. And the next thing that he does is start traveling around to the synagogues. He's a traveling evangelist, or as people in the Gospels often refer to him, as a prophet or a teacher. He is apparently self-taught rabbi. And so he's going around guest preaching at people. A lot of people begin their ministry in their home church. I went to Truett Seminary, and Truett Seminary is named after George W. Truett, who was a longtime pastor of First Baptist Dallas in the early 20th century. And he was called to ministry by his home church at the age of 18. Their church needed a pastor, and they asked him to do it, and he said no. And they said, "Well, we already voted you in." And so that's how he became the pastor of his home church. The story goes that Will Campbell, the great civil rights leader, civil rights participator, he was one of the first and Anglo civil rights participants, The story goes that he was ordained by his home church and got his PhD in religion from Princeton, but that he glued his church ordination certificate on top of his Princeton diploma, because the church ordination certificate was the important one, because it was his home church that had said, this person is gifted for ministry, this person is called to preach. So Jesus didn't begin his ministry in his home church, but he returns there. They've heard the word that this hometown guy has come back, and they're excited to hear what he has to say. And if they're really excited to hear what he has to say, when he quotes from the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah, who is giving this word originally to the exiles, people who, we've talked about that before, that the kingdom of Israel, the nation of Israel, had been taken away from their homeland. Everything that God had promised them seemed to be in doubt. Their land wasn't theirs anymore. It belonged to Babylon. They were in exile. Their children were being trained to be good Babylonians, and everything seemed to be at risk. And the word of Isaiah comes to them and says, God has anointed me to preach the gospel, to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. And that would have sparked an idea in them that had not ever happened. The law talked about the year of Jubilee. In the year of Jubilee, all the debts were canceled. It's an exciting thing to think about, isn't it? Every 50 years, Israel was supposed to cancel everyone's debts. There is no record that that ever happened, but they were supposed to. Every year, anybody who had become an indentured servant or a slave who had so much debt that they had to sell themselves or someone in their family to pay off debt, every 50 years, they were free. Every 50 years, the ownership of land was supposed to return to its original ownership. That was the year of Jubilee. No record that that ever happened, but that was in the law, that they were supposed to do that. And when he says the favorable year of the Lord, that's what they would have heard. Jesus coming and saying, the exile is over. For the people of Nazareth, even though they're in the land of Israel, they are ruled by the Roman Empire. A town down the road from Nazareth, a place called Sepphoris, the Roman Empire had wiped out that town probably about the time that Jesus was a teenager. And so they would say, we're in Israel, but we're not home yet from the exile. The promises have not yet been fulfilled. For the people of Nazareth, the exile might have as well been the day before yesterday. But Jesus has come now and says, the word of the prophet Isaiah is fulfilled today. The exile is over. The covenant of God is restored. You will be delivered. When they hear, preach the gospel to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, they would have at least heard, you will be delivered from foreign oppression. The throne of David will be restored. They would have heard, a new era of peace and justice and the worship of God is here. The very presence of God will be with his people in a powerful way. And today is that day. And all the people said, amen. And they got really excited. And they said, this is amazing. What happened was, and Jesus is not just saying this in general, they would have understood this to mean, remember, he's been traveling around and performing miracles, the other gospels tell us. And so Jesus has just announced his candidacy for Messiah. There's been a lot of candidate announcements in the news lately, and Jesus just announced his candidacy. There were other people that others had claimed to be the Messiah. There's a partial list of them in the book of Acts. And Jesus just said, I'm here to announce today to my hometown that I am running for Messiah. And everybody got really excited. And so they're excited about this. The response at first is really positive. This is amazing. And they're blown away. Everyone is speaking well of him and wondering, where did this come from? And then they start saying, isn't this Joseph's son? Now, this is one of those places where we wish we could hear tone of voice in Scripture, because there's two ways to say that. If you've ever seen somebody do something amazing that you didn't know they were capable of, you hear that tone of voice. Wow, I didn't know you could do that. And so these are people who've grown up with Jesus. They've seen Jesus grow up. And it may be that some of them were saying it in the way of, wow, I had no idea that his ambitions were so high. To be the Messiah. I didn't know he could do this, could teach in this way. This story, though, is also in the Gospels of Matthew and Mark. And in Matthew and Mark, the whole point of the story is that the people of Nazareth are scandalized by Jesus' message. And they say, isn't this Joseph's son? In other words, isn't he aiming a little too high? Isn't it a little too much to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord? Is that really in your realm of possibility? For you to say that God has anointed you to preach the gospel to the poor and that the Spirit of the Lord is upon you, isn't that seems a little much. Jesus, they think, his head has gotten a little big. for this hometown boy from Nazareth. And so Jesus quotes them what he'll quote here in a second. But that, for them, Matthew and Mark in their Gospels, that's the point of this story, is the scandal. Who does this guy think he is? And the scandal of unbelief. At first they receive the message, and then they start thinking about it, and they start thinking about the person who delivered the message to them, and they say, I'm not sure I buy this person telling me that. It just seems a little too big for this guy that we grew up with. The question is, who is this person? Doubtful of his origins. But Luke has a different emphasis than Matthew and Mark. Matthew and Mark don't include the actual sermon, but Luke does. And the sermon's not over yet. There's still some commentary. So look with me at Luke chapter 4, starting in verse 23 and going through verse 30. He said to them, no doubt you will quote this proverb to me, physician, heal yourself. Whatever we heard was done at Capernaum, do here in your hometown as well. And he said, truly I say to you, no prophet is welcome in his hometown. But I say to you in truth, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, when a great famine came over all the land. And yet Elijah was sent to none of them, but only to Zarephath in the land of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. We read that story last week. Verse 28, and all in the synagogue were filled with rage as they heard these things, and they rose up and cast him out of the city and led him to the brow of the hill on which their city had been built in order to throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, he went his way. And that was the end of Jesus' sermon. Well, that escalated quickly. They were filled with rage. And Jesus lays it on thick here. He responds first to their, who does this guy think he is? And he says, I just wanted you guys to know I expected this. That I expected to come in here and you guys say to me, physician, heal yourself. In other words, Jesus has proclaimed the favorable year of the Lord. He's proclaimed God's presence with them. And they want to see it in Jesus' life. They say, show us, prove it to us. And that's, Jesus knows that that's what they're looking for from him. And then he starts meddling. There's a moment sometimes in a sermon where the preacher goes from preaching to meddling. You know what that moment is? It's when you start to think, he's talking about me. This is the moment where Jesus starts meddling and says, he lays it on thick. He doesn't just give one example. He gives two examples, one from Elijah and one from Elisha. And he says, just remember that when God shows up and when God does the things that I've promised that God is going to do, God's boundaries are not necessarily your boundaries. God may not be as focused on you as much as he is focused on others. And so in the Old Testament, Elijah and Elisha, God healed a leper from Syria. When God provided miraculously for someone in the midst of famine, it wasn't for an Israelite, it was for this woman in the land of Sidon in modern-day Lebanon. He reminds the people. When he proclaims the favorable year of the Lord, he reminds them that God is at liberty to do what he wants. God is at liberty to do what he wants, particularly through his prophets. God is not constrained to your wrong ideas about what he's trying to do. God is not constrained by that. So they get really angry at him, and they cast him out of the city. He is no longer welcome in Nazareth, and they try to throw him off a cliff, and it says he passed through their midst. Some have read this as though Jesus somehow became intangible and passed through them. I don't think that's very likely what happened. I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but mobs have a lot more courage than individuals. And so I think when it came, casting him out of the city was something that a mob could do, but throwing him off a cliff is something that somebody has to get up close enough to him and push him. And so whoever came up close enough to him to push him first had to look him in the eye. Have you ever known anybody that could just stop people with their look? Jenny's grandmother was about this tall and was an English and drama teacher, and she had a reputation for just being able to stop people in their tracks and giving them the death stare. And my guess is, and this is not original with me, one of my seminary professors said this, my guess is that Jesus just started looking people in the eye. And they said, you go, why don't you, and he passed through their midst. Nobody decided that individually they were ready to lay a hand on him. As a mob, they were ready to do that, but not as an individual. I think that's what happened. So in this sermon, it starts out so great. Everybody was speaking well of him, and they said, this is fantastic. This is the best sermon we've heard here in a long time. And then it ends with them trying to kill him. So there's a wobbling point and a tipping point. There's a point at which things are on a little shaky ground, and there's a point where tip, and it just all falls over. The wobbling point is, who is this? The wobbling point is, who does this man think he is? The wobbling point is, can this person, can Jesus be believed when he tells us something? Can Jesus be believed when he tells us that something is going to happen? Can Jesus be trusted? That's the wobbling point. And that's the point that Matthew and Mark emphasize in their story. They emphasize the unbelief that the people of Nazareth, they were wobbly on that. They didn't think that Jesus could be trusted to be who he said he was, to do what he said he was going to do. Luke goes for the tipping point moment. That's his emphasis. The tipping point, the big moment, the touch, that last straw that turns this moment from this sermon, from the best sermon to the worst sermon, is the moment they have to reckon with the whole Word of God and not just their favorite part of the Word of God. Mm-hmm. The tipping point is the moment where they have to reckon with the fact that God has a bigger agenda than they do. That God is not so much interested in their agenda as much as he is calling them to be about God's agenda. That's the tipping point. So Jesus just announced his candidacy as Messiah. But then he follows that up by saying, I'm not just going to be the Messiah of Israel, but also of Syria and also of Lebanon, your enemies, the people that have been your enemies since Old Testament times. I'm going to be their Messiah too. And that's when they get real mad. What if our candidates, when they declared their candidacy, everybody, you know, makes fantastic promises when they declare their candidacy. What if a candidate stood up and said, I'm going to do all these amazing things for our nation, but not just our nation. I'm going to do them for these other nations too. That might be the point in which people would say, who is this person? Can they be trusted? And not just for these other nations, but I'm going to do great things for our enemies as well. And at that point, I think people would get mad and say, who does this guy think he is? Who does he even think he's talking to? That's what Jesus has just done. He's declared his candidacy for Messiah. But he's not just going to bless Israel. He's going to bless Israel's enemies as well. So the good news is that the good news of this passage is still true. Good news. God's promises are coming true. That's what Jesus said to his hometown. God's promises are coming true. Also, and you get to decide whether this is good news or bad news, also, they are coming true in a way that requires you to rethink and reimagine God's agenda. When God brings his promises true, they happen in a way that is going to confirm what we believe and also challenge what we believe and also challenge what we do. David says in Psalm 19, the law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. When we encounter the Word of God, it lifts us up and sets us on solid ground. The author of Hebrews says the Word of God is a double-edged sword, dividing into joints and marrow. The same Word of God. The same Word of God restores our soul. And the same Word of God is a double-edged sword. Cuts both ways. Cuts coming and going. Both of these things are true about God's Word. It's true about God's written Word, the Bible, and it's true about God's incarnate Word, the capital W Word, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ. Restores the soul and is a double-edged sword. I like it to say it this way. Scripture, in general, and Jesus in particular, comforts the afflicted and afflicts the comfortable. I like that. The same person says, come to me, you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And also says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Woe to you who set a stumbling block in the way of any of these little ones. It would be better if you had a heavy rock tied around your neck and you were thrown into the ocean. It's the same person says that. And Jesus is not schizophrenic. It's that the Word of God is a double-edged sword and what restores our soul. It gives us not just what we want, but what we need. And what we need sometimes is that double-edged sword. So Jesus still, the message he preached in Nazareth is still true. The Spirit of the Lord is upon him to preach the gospel to the poor. The Nazareth people would have heard that as them. Oh, he's talking about us. We're the poor. And there would have been very few people who would have argued with that. They heard it for them. Now, Jesus fulfills the promises of God for them, and it's true for us too. He comforts us with the truth. He's anointed me to preach the good news. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are downtrodden. That's still true. Jesus still comforts us with the truth and frees the captives and heals the blind and relieves the oppressed. But it's also still true that Jesus challenges us like he challenged the people of Nazareth. God's agenda is bigger than just you. God's agenda extends even to your enemies. He challenges us, take up your cross and follow me. He challenges us, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. He challenges us, whoever would be first must be last and must be servant of all. And especially notice that no one, not the Syrians, not the Lebanese, no one can be automatically excluded from God's agenda. The people of Nazareth, that's what offended them so much, is that if there was anybody that wasn't going to be included in this good news, it would be these people who have been our enemies for generations. And Jesus says, nope, God's got his own agenda that goes beyond the boundary lines that we've set. And I would say to us, God's got his own agenda that goes beyond the two-party system. Beware of anybody who tells you that their party is Jesus' party when their party doesn't act like Jesus. Just beware. It works both ways. The word of God is a double-edged sword, and it cuts to the right and it cuts to the left. God is an equal opportunity comforter and challenger. That's the big picture, is that we worship a God who has an agenda that extends to every tribe and tongue and nation and people. We have a God whose agenda does not automatically exclude anybody, but he puts us and calls us to be part of that agenda. One of my favorite moments in which the Israelites have to reckon with God's agenda is when the Israelites are on their way into the Promised Land, and Joshua is about to have their first battle. They're about to march around the walls of Jericho, and he's out praying, and he sees a person, an armed person. He draws his sword and says, "Are you for us or for our enemies?" He doesn't know that he's just drawn on an angel. And the angel says, "No, but I am for the God of Israel." "What do you mean, no?" That wasn't one of the options. "Are you for us or are you for our enemies?" And this angelic being says, I'm on God's side here. The question is, whose side are you on? Are you on God's side? Are you up for what God is calling you to do? That's the big picture. So with a narrower focus than the big picture, let's look at our own lives and the life of our church. The Word of God comforts us and it challenges us. Let's look at this moment that we're about to observe, the moment of the Lord's Supper, the moment in which we remember the broken body and the shed blood of the Lord, the moment in which Jesus didn't just say to us, this is the way of salvation, but showed us this is the way of salvation, when he offered himself for his enemies, and when he offered himself for those who were separated from God by their sin. Hey, that's me, and that's us. Something that we could not do anything about, he did. Not because we were so great, but because he loved us. That's what we were made for, was to be with him. The comfort of that is so deep. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Not just you as a part of a body, but you individually, that Christ died for you so that you could have right relationship with God and right relationship with other people, right relationship with creation itself. His body was broken, his blood was shed. So hear that comfort today. You are included in the invitation. It means something to be invited to someone's table. It means something to be welcomed and said, we have a spot here for you. And Jesus is inviting you to partake, inviting us to partake in his table. Come and take. This is my body broken for you. He includes you in the invitation. But hear also the challenge in that. Paul encourages the early Christian churches to examine themselves and to say, where in my life do I still need the transforming work of Christ to remind me of who I really am, of a person who's part of this body of Christ? Hear the challenge. If anyone wishes to follow me, let them take up their cross and do so. Let them take up their cross daily and do so. Let them lay down their own agendas and pick up my agenda, the agenda of self-sacrificial love. There's a saying that's been around a long time that says the medium is the message. In other words, the way in which you present something says as much about the message that you're presenting. This is the message of Jesus Christ for us. This symbol behind me is the message. This is the way of salvation. This is the way in which God preaches the gospel to the poor, proclaims release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, who frees those who are downtrodden, is through the self-sacrificial love of his Son, his body broken, his blood shed. When we come to the Lord's Supper, we're supposed to remember these three things. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. We are part of a bigger story, but it starts with you individually. You make that choice. I choose to believe what Christ did for me. I choose to follow him with my life, and I accept his desire to transform me into a person who lives a life of self-sacrificial love, even for my enemies, however you define that. That's the way. That's the medium. That's the message that he wants to proclaim to us. I'm going to ask our deacons to come.